بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
QSEP.com Your step-by-step guide to learning Islam online. Tawheed explained from the book Aqidatu Tawheed by Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan Al-Fawzan. Presentation and explanation by Dr. Abdullah Al-Farisi.
الحمد لله وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن نبينا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. In this session, the Sheikh speaks about the meaning of Tawheed and the different kinds of Tawheed. First, the Sheikh gives a general statement giving the meaning of Tawheed briefly, and that is to say Tawheed is to unify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with creation and taking care of his creation and to single him out in all worship, to leave out worshipping other than him, and to approve for him all that which he has approved for himself of the beautiful names and high attributes, provided that one should not, or one should glorify him from all deficiencies. One should glorify him from all deficiencies. So this expression explaining Tawheed includes the three types of Tawheed. And then the Sheikh speaks about each type in more detail. Those three types of Tawheed have been proven by the Book of Allah, the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and by the consensus of the Muslim scholars. Sheikh Abdullah ibn Humayd rahimahullah, one of the great scholars who was at his time the Grand Mufti of the Saudi government, has a small book about Tawheed in which he mentioned the consensus of the Muslim scholars on dividing Tawheed into three types, that is lordship, worship, and names and attributes. And the great Mufassir al-Shanqiti rahimahullah in Adwa al-Bayan mentioned a similar statement. Also, when Sheikh ibn Baz rahimahullah was asked about dividing Tawheed into four types, he said this has no basis in the Islamic sources or Islamic Sharia. And Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, when he was asked, he said this is an innovation, and he strongly opposed this kind of division and warned against those who make any different division than what has been agreed upon by the scholars. Some contemporary writers who were affected by the writings of Sayyid Qutb and the like say that dividing Tawheed is a matter of ijtihad. And Dr. Salah Al-Sawi, in his book Al-Thawabit Wal-Mutaghayyirat, mentioned what is even worse than this, saying that that which goes into the meaning of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah and Sifat is a matter of ijtihad. And this shows how ignorant are those who are being considered to be the leaders of the Islamic da'wah and Islamic activities. If someone declares that he doesn't know for sure what goes into Tawheed al-Rububiyyah and Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah and Tawheed al-Asma'i wa-Sifat, which is the foundation of religion, then how could he be trusted to set up rules and laws and regulations and give fatwas for da'wah and other than da'wah? Indeed, this is a catastrophe, as Sheikh Abdulrazzaq al-Abbad mentioned in his reply on the book of the Sufi al-Saqaf. In the footnotes, he replied on Dr. Salah al-Sawi as well, and he mentioned that it is a catastrophe for the Islamic da'wah to have such leaders. And the division of Tawheed is mentioned in the Book of Allah in so many places, so many verses. But what is more important and more obvious is the importance of mentioning this division, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has opened his book with a surah which not only has shown the division of Tawheed into three types, but it has been almost totally devoted to that kind of division. And it has shown this division from two or three aspects in this surah alone. That is Surah Al-Fatiha, which is the opening of the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first statement in the surah, which is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, this statement by itself includes clearly the three types of Tawheed. Bism, in the name. The explanation of ism here is not only one name or a particular name, but ism here includes all the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which of course indicate his attributes, because every name shows an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is regarding the attributes of Allah. This is one kind of Tawheed. Then the word Allah, this name, comes from Ilah. Ilah is the one who is worshipped. And it could be true Ilah, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means the only one worthy of being worshipped. And it could be a false Ilah, someone or something which is worshipped, but it has been worshipped falsely, like the idols, like the angels were worshipped, like the pious people were worshipped and are still worshipped until nowadays, and so on. And then the lordship comes from Ar-Rabb, which is also one of Allah's names. Ar-Rabb is a name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so it is included in the Bismillah, all names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including Ar-Rabb, including Al-Malik, the king, which is also lordship, as well as attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including As-Sayyid, which means the master or the lord, including Al-Hakim, which has many meanings amongst which is the ruler. And that is one of the aspects of lordship also. So this statement, which is the opening of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is the opening of the opening surah as well, which is Al-Fatiha, or it's the beginning of the opening surah. This statement, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, by itself includes the three aspects of Tawheed. And then when you go to the next statement immediately, it by itself again has the three kinds of Tawheed very clearly. Because Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Alhamd means all praises. So whatever praise is deserved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this includes all the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is, when we describe Allah that He is the most knowledgeable, this is a praise. When we say He is the Almighty, this is a praise. So all praises, this is the Tawheed al-Asma'i wa-Sifat. This is the Tawheed of names and attributes of Allah. And Allah, again, is from Ilah, which is Uluhiyya, worship. This is Tawheed al-Uluhiyya. And then Rabbul Alameen, clearly Lordship, Rabb. So this statement also has the division of Tawheed, the three divisions or the three types of Tawheed very clearly. Another division in this surah, we can consider this whole statement, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, to have the meaning of Lordship, Rabbul Alameen. And then the next statement, or the next two statements, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm Al-Din, these are attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this shows the Tawheed of attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the third one is إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُد means we worship you alone. And عِبَادَه is أُلُوهِيَّة again. That is worship. So we have only in this surah, we can see clearly the division of Tawheed in three manners. From the statement Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim by itself, from the statement Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen by itself, and from the first three or four verses, we can see again the same division, the three kinds of Tawheed. Then if we go to the first order in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is in verse 25 in Surah Al-Baqarah, we find this division twice, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first says, Ya ayyuhan nasu ubudu rabbakum. I'budu rabbakum. I'budu is an order to unify him in worship. Rabbakum, lordship. That is, you must single out in worship that one who is your Lord. So it is not enough to believe in him as a Lord, but we have to single him out in worship. The Arabs, as the author will show inshallah, believed that he is the Lord, but they did not single him out in worship. So the order came, you must single out in worship the one who is your Lord, the one who is your creator, the one who is your master, the one who is your ruler, and so on. So this is very clear that we have worship and lordship, and that lordship by itself is not enough for someone to be from the people of Tawheed. Those people were mushriks. They were mushriks. They were idol worshippers. They were making angels and pious people in the form of statues and idols and making them as objects of worship, or means between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a form of making them objects of worship also. And then the verse right after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا تجعلوا لله أندادا وأنتم تعلمون. And this is the first statement which forbids something, and that something is shirk. So the first order that we mentioned was the order to worship Allah alone. And the first thing to forbid is to stay away from worshiping other than Allah. لا تجعلوا لله أندادا وأنتم تعلمون. Again, in this verse, it is very clear that we have worship and lordship. لا تجعلوا لله أندادا. Do not set up rivals with Allah in worship. وأنتم تعلمون, because you know that there is no Lord but Him, no Creator but Him, no Provider but Him, no Sustainer but Him, no Master and Ruler but Him. They knew that, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them that they knew it. They did not deny that Allah is the Lord, that Allah is the Creator, that Allah is the Master, that Allah is the Ruler. They did not deny anything of that. But they didn't think that it is forbidden for them to worship others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, provided that they believed that Allah is the Lord and the Master, and He is the greatest one to be worshipped. So they thought by doing that, they are believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed them that they will not be believers until they satisfy the two kinds of tawheed, that is worship and lordship. And lordship is not enough. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentioned in Quran in some other verses saying, وَمَا يُؤْمِنُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ بِاللَّهِ إِلَّا وَهُمْ مُشْرِكُونَ, describing the Arab pagans, the idol worshippers, the angel worshippers, those people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying about them that they have faith in Allah, but yet they commit shirk. So Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma explained this verse saying, they have faith that Allah is the Creator, the Provider, the Sustainer, but they commit shirk in His worship. So he pointed out two kinds of tawheed. The first is the lordship, that you believe that Allah is the Creator and the Sustainer and so on. And the second is the tawheed of worship, al-ibadah or uluhiyya. So it is very clear as the sun. And this is in tens of verses in Quran. It is clear like this, and this division, rububiyya and uluhiyya. And no one ever said that this kind of division is an innovation, except grave worshippers in the late centuries that we live in now. They accused first Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah of innovating, as they say, the division of Tawheed. And those who could not attribute it to Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, maybe because Shaykh al-Islam is very popular in their area and they don't dare to declare anything against him, they attributed to Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, and they say he is the one who innovated this division. And of course they are liars, and they know that they are liars. They are liars and they know that they are liars, because this kind of division has been mentioned as early as the time of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We mentioned an example of the explanation of Abdullah ibn Abbas for the verse, and he pointed out clearly to those two kinds of tawheed, lordship and worship. And the names and attributes go into the lordship, because the Lord is the one who deserves all the perfect attributes. And it has been mentioned in the earliest books written. We have books as early as Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. He mentioned clearly in his Aqidah book, Al-Fiqh Al-Akbar, Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he mentioned the general rule regarding the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that all attributes of Allah must be approved of. And then he went on into detail, mentioning the hands of Allah, mentioning the eyes of Allah, mentioning the face of Allah, and so on. This book has been written in the early centuries of Islam, as early as the second century or the beginning of the third century of Islam. And in the year 150 Hijri or 170 Hijri, this was the time of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. And then this kind of division was mentioned in the early writings of Aqidah by the great scholar Ibn Battah al-Akbari, who was a Hanbali scholar, and by Ibn Jarir al-Tabari in his Aqidah book, he's a Shafi'i scholar, and Ibn Manda, he has a book about Tawheed, and he mentioned lordship and worship, Rububiyyah, Uluhiyyah. Then he mentioned the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he went into detail regarding this. At-Tawheed by Ibn Khuzayma. He mentioned the aspects of Tawheed. And many other books which have been written in that early time mentioned the Rububiyyah and the Uluhiyyah and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all those people were before Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah by at least 300 years. At least 300 years. So how could Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah be the innovator of such kind of knowledge? Of course, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah was replying on those saint worshippers and grave worshippers in his time, and pointing to them clearly that they do not understand Tawheed, and that their understanding of Tawheed is no better than the understanding of the mushriks, Abu Jahl and people like that. And those people, they got worse. Now they are much worse in understanding Tawheed than even Abu Jahl and the idol worshippers at the time of early Islam. As Sheikh Muhammad ibn Ibrahim, the Grand Mufti of Saudi, said in one of his writings, he said about those scholars who attribute themselves to the Sunnah or the other scholars who attribute themselves to other than the Sunnah, he said, those people who wear big turbans, Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab knew about Tawheed more than they did. Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab knew about Tawheed more than they did. And he is right. Because Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab confessed totally that all lordship belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But those people nowadays, unfortunately, believe that in the name of wilayah, wali, and so on, they believe that some pious people could run the affairs of the creation, which is lordship. Abu Jahl never believed in this. They believe that the wali has a high position and therefore he will never be refused if he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala anything. They believe that the walis gather together every season. Some of them say Hajj season, some of them say the Mawlid season, some of them put other dates. They say they gather in groups of 70 walis. Some of them say they gather in groups of 40 walis. Some of them say 77, some of them say 44, whatever they have in their books. That they gather to run all the affairs of the creation. And if Abu Jahl were to hear them say this, he would tell them, you are mushriks and you have to be fought because you are mushriks. Because there is no one who runs the affairs except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But those people say that because the walis have high positions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted them with this favor and made them run the affairs of his creation. So they provide and they sustain and they deprive and they do whatever. And this is great shirk in rububiyyah. The mushriks at the time of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab were only committing shirk by setting up intermediaries between them and Allah, believing that angels were the daughters of Allah, may Allah be glorified from their kufr and false belief, believing that angels were the daughters of Allah, they would call upon the angels so that the angels would intercede for them with their father, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like the Christians do with Jesus. This was the shirk of Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. And also the pious people like Lat, Uzza, like Yaghuth, Ya'uq, those are all names of pious people in that time. They used to call upon them because they thought that they are walis and they are close to Allah and they can intercede between them and Allah. This was their belief. The mushriks nowadays, unfortunately, most of the mushriks nowadays who claim to be Muslims, who go to the graves and call upon the pious people, as they say, whether they are pious or not, that's something else. But they call upon them not for being intermediates between them and Allah. No, no. They call upon them because they think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already assigned them to answer the calls and to deliver the good and to forbid the bad things and the harmful things. So they believe that they themselves can do them all this. Not that they can intercede between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is worse than the shirk of the Arabs. This is worse than the shirk of the Arabs. And this is the situation with the majority of the contemporary mushriks. They are of this category. Some who are very smart in comparison to those say what Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab was saying, that the awliya do not have anything in lordship. They don't create, they don't provide, and so on. But they just intercede for us. That's all. And they call upon them to intercede. And those are the smart ones of those mushriks. And those smart ones are the ones like Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab. And they are little in number compared to the others. And we still find people who claim that those are Muslims and no one should call them kafirs just because they have Muslim names in their passports. And just because they utter by their tongue, La ilaha illallah. They forgot that the Jews were saying La ilaha illallah at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they were objecting to the Arab pagans when they saw them worshipping idols. And they were saying bad things about them. But still they were kafirs. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered one of his companions to go to them in Yemen and call them to La ilaha illallah. And they were saying by tongue La ilaha illallah. So what is the need for the companion to go and ask them to say La ilaha illallah when they are saying by tongue La ilaha illallah? Because La ilaha illallah is not just false statement by tongue. There is no meaning to shout loudly and say by your tongue, La ilaha illallah, 100 times, 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times, whatever. And by your hand, you worship other than Allah by sacrificing an animal for the saint, such and such wali. This is worshipping him. And La ilaha illallah means no one is worthy of being worshipped except Allah. So you are saying a very heavy word by your tongue. You say, La ilaha illallah. No one is worthy of being worshipped but Allah. And then you worship by sacrificing an animal to please a dead man so that he intercedes for you with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or you supplicate to him. Or you give the, what you call nadr, the oath. Huh? All these are worships. So if you worship them in any way, you are immediately breaking your statement, La ilaha illallah. As a matter of fact, your statement of saying La ilaha illallah can be broken by much, much, much simpler acts than this and much, much easier words than this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the true hadith, a man who might say a word, not paying attention to it, and because of it, he will be punished by being in the downest or most deep place in hellfire. And that most deep place in hellfire is the place of kafirs, the worst of kafirs. By one word, you could go in the deepest place in hellfire and be a kafir. By cussing Allah, by cussing the messenger, by mocking a verse, by mocking a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by mocking a clear sunnah of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you go out of Islam, you will be a kafir. By jokingly prostrate for an idol, for example, or a grave or whatever, jokingly, you become a kafir. So how about if you do it not jokingly, seriously, thinking that this engraved will intercede between you and Allah? Then this is clearly stronger kufr. And how about if you go further by believing that this saint not only will intercede, but he actually will deliver the good to you? He doesn't need to go and intercede with Allah. Allah has already given him the authority to do this. This is even a much and much greater shirk. And this is the kind of shirk, as I mentioned, that is most prevalent in the grave worshippers nowadays. So how could one say that those people say La ilaha illallah, and therefore one should excuse them and one should not dare to call them kafirs because it is a big word to say to a Muslim that he's a kafir? Yeah, it is a very big word to say to a Muslim that he's kafir. But who is the Muslim? This is not a Muslim. He's a mushrik. He's worshipping other than Allah. So it is even more dangerous not to call a kafir a kafir. If you call a Muslim a kafir due to anger, this will not take you out of Islam. This will be a small kufr, kufr amal. This will not take you out of Islam. If you say to a Muslim, you are a kafir due to your anger, this is a great sin, but this is not kufr, not great kufr. It will not take you out of Islam. This is a small kufr. But if there is someone who is a mushrik, worshipping other than Allah, and you say he is a Muslim, then you are a kafir, out of Islam. So what is more dangerous? What is more dangerous? Not only this, but even if you have doubts, he might be a Muslim and he might be a kafir. You say, I'm not sure. You are a kafir. Just because you have doubts that he is not a kafir, you are a kafir. So it's very important. This is the meaning of kufr and taghut. Kufr and taghut means you have to totally disassociate yourself from every kafir, every mushrik. You must declare that he is a kafir. You must declare it. And you must disassociate yourself from him. You must hate him for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the meaning of kufr in taghut. And those people nowadays who point to the Salafis and to the people of Tawheed that you call Muslims kafirs and so on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has punished them with believing that most of the people in the Muslim societies are kafirs nowadays. All the rulers are kafirs. Most of the people are kafirs. Why? Because they say all the rulers are not ruling with the rule of Allah. And all the people, or most of the people, except few, one group here and one group there, Jama'a Islamiyah here and Jama'a Islamiyah there, Ikhwan Muslimun here and Ikhwan Muslimun there, those are only the Muslims, because they deny the situation where rulers are ruling by laws and things like that. And the rest of the people are kafirs. Expressions like Mujtama'at Jahiliyyah, Jahili societies. Sayyid Qutb says, ارتدت البشرية كلها بما فيها المجتمعات التي تزعم لنفسها أنها مسلمة. All humanity has went out of Islam, including those societies which claim Islam. And he said, in explaining one ayah in Surah Yunus, ayah I think 80 or 80 something, he says about معابد الجاهلية, the temples of mushriks, he says, the believers must avoid the so-called mosques nowadays, which are built by those rulers. يعني those are temples of shirk, the mosques. Okay. And this is most corruption, to consider the mosques as places of shirk. And this is the most corruption, to consider most of the people in the Muslim countries are kafirs. Okay, we don't consider them kafirs. Yani we say, for example, in a society where there are, let's say, 6 million or 10 million grave worshippers, but the number of the people in that society is 60, 70 million. So what's 10 million to 70 million? Okay. So if we say that those people are mushriks, still the majority, alhamdulillah, are Muslims. When we come to a society where there are 200 million and only 20, 30, 40 million are committing those acts and approving of those acts, but the majority are not. Okay. So we don't consider them kafirs. But those people who claim that those clearly mushrik people, they are Muslims, and they are giving such statements as the whole societies are jahiliya, kafir societies, and all the rulers are kafirs, and no scholar approves of their claim that all the rulers are kafirs and most of the societies are kafirs. So therefore, it is very important to know the distinction between those kinds of tawheed. Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah mentioned that not knowing this distinction is the cause of falling into great shirk. And what Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab said is preceded by the statement of the great Khalifa Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu, when he said, إِنَّمَا تُنْقَضُ عُرَى الْإِسْلَامِ عُرْوَةٌ عُرْوَةٌ إذا نشأ في الإسلام من لم يعرف الجاهلية. The branches of Islam will be invalidated, broken one by one when someone is raised in Islam not knowing the ignorance and not knowing what is opposite to Islam. So he will be an easy prey for what is against Islam, even shirk. If he doesn't know what is shirk, he will fall into it. He will fall into it. This Sawi, in his book, Thawabit wal-Mutaghayirat, he makes it a matter of ijtihad to say we have Tawheed al-Rububiyyah and Uluhiyyah and al-Asma al-Sifat. And he makes it ijtihad to say that what goes into Tawheed al-Rububiyyah and Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. He cites an example saying that Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah makes Hakimiyyah rulership goes under Uluhiyyah worship, and Sayyid Qutb and Maududi and others make it in lordship. Yani look at this sick statement. It is even sicker than the statement of Ash'aris who say مذهب السلفي أسلم ومذهب الخلفي أعلم وأحكم. This statement Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah refuted in his book Al-Hamawiyya by saying, Shaykh al-Islam says, we hear some of the stooges, al-aghbiya, say, مذهب السلفي أسلم ومذهب الخلفي أعلم وأحكم, that the way of the Salaf, the predecessors regarding aqidah and sifat, is only safer, as they claim. But the way of the Khalaf, meaning the people who came later, the Asha'ira and so on, it is أعلم وأحكم. It is more deep in knowledge and more deep in wisdom. This is a contradiction. This is a contradictory statement. How could it be safe without knowledge and wisdom? How could something be safe without knowledge and wisdom? They don't know what's coming out of their heads. They say something and make people laugh at them. And then they say, مذهب السلف, attributing something to the Salaf, which the Salaf were not upon. And that is to say that we don't indulge into explaining the attributes of Allah at all. We don't understand any meaning from the attributes of Allah. This is not the way of the Salaf. This is not even the way of the cows and mice and those animals which know some attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has put in their instinct something about him. We find some animals who raise their legs and head and hands to the heavens asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they know that he is the provider and he is the sustainer. And those people say that we should not think of the meanings of those names and attributes, and we should not consider any meanings to them at all. And they say, this is the way of the Salaf. This is the way of Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and the most knowledgeable people after the prophets of Allah. May Allah be pleased with them. So that's why Shaykh al-Islam is calling them the stooges. And the statement of Salah al-Sawi saying that, for example, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah considers rulership part of Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah, while Sayyid Qutb and other scholars consider it from Tawheed al-Rububiyyah. And he says this is an ijtihad, yani approving of this. And this is because those people did not understand the meaning of Tawheed. Sayyid Qutb, in his explanation, Dhilal al-Qur'an, wherever he comes to the word ilah, he explains it by meanings of lordship only. Only lordship meanings. Ilah means the only one who deserves to be worshipped. Everywhere he explains it by lordship. Lordship. The one who is the creator, the ruler, the creator, the ruler, the creator, the ruler. That's all his explanations. All through Dhilal al-Quran. All through it. And he says that this kind of tawheed, which is rulership, is the kind of tawheed which all the messengers were sent to preach their people. This is nonsense. This is nonsense. We read the Quran, we are not blind followers. It is very clear in Quran what the message of the prophets was, and that is اعبدوا ربكم. اعبدوا ربكم. For every nation, Allah has sent a messenger, starting his message by saying اعبدوا ربكم. So the order was to worship, not to make him a lord or consider him a lord. As a matter of fact, there was no need for any prophet to tell his people, consider Allah your lord, because they already did. Or consider him the creator, or consider him the ruler, because they already did. So the order was worship him, single him out in worship, single him out in love, single him out in fear, single him out in reverence, single him out in prayers, single him out in supplication, single him out in prayers, in kneeling, in prostration, in tawaf, in nadr. This was the order. As Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah mentioned, after mentioning the types of shirk in his time, going around the graves and seeking the blessings from the graves and the engraved and things like that, he said, وَهَذَا أَصْلُ شِرْكِ الْعَالَمِ. This is the root of all shirk in this world. This is the root. And those people nowadays, like students of Sayyid Qutb, Muhammad Surur, says, why is it that we see some people, not scholars, some people who go and disapprove of some poor people's acts, like going around the graves and this, things like that. So those are the poor people, the mushriks. Okay? And he is objecting to those who forbid them from doing this. And he's saying, why are they doing this and keeping quiet about the shirk in the castles? Of course, everything in the castles to them is shirk, because they are not the ones who are in the castles. Tawheed only comes when they sit in the castles and all the money is under their hand and all the power is under their hand. Then Tawheed is established. This is their Tawheed. This is the Tawheed of Hasan al-Banna. This is the Tawheed of Sayyid Qutb. This is the Tawheed of Mawdudi. This is the Tawheed of Surur. This is the Tawheed of Sawi. This is their Tawheed. And that is why, as Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah has mentioned, when they say that Tawheed al-Hakimiyyah, the rulership, is one kind of Tawheed by itself, he says, those people are politicizing Tawheed. Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah said, they are politicians. This is not Islamic Sharia. This is not knowledge. This is not Aqeedah. This is politics. And he's right. Because what they mean by Tawheed is to be rulers and to rule the people. And in order for them to achieve that, you must keep quiet and not say a word about any shirk, because people will run away from us and we cannot use them to reach rulership. Can you imagine those people are callers to Allah and callers to Tawheed? No. They are callers to themselves. As Shaykh al-Islam Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah mentioned in Kitab al-Tawheed, in one of the issues on the verse which says, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ. Say, this is my path, I call to Allah. He said, a lot of those who call to Allah, claimingly, actually, they are calling to themselves, not to Allah. يعني if you want to call to Allah, your main goal should be saving the people from hellfire. Your main goal should be guiding the people. And what is more guidance than Tawheed? And those people not only don't call to Tawheed, but they prevent people who call to Tawheed because it's against their interests. And maybe they are themselves mushriks, but they are showing themselves to be not mushriks and things like that. This also could be the situation. This is, يعني, this could be the situation for many of those people, that they are indeed mushriks by themselves, but there is no advantage that they can see from making it out loud or making it clear for the people that they believe this, those things. The Sheikh then starts about Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, talking about Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, and he says Tawheed al-Rububiyyah includes the following, or the speech about Tawheed al-Rububiyyah will include the following. The first chapter, the meaning of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah and the fact that it is implanted in the instinct and the fact that the mushriks approved of it. The second chapter is to show the meaning of the word Ar-Rabb in Quran and the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how the nations before visualized the Lordship and how to reply on them. And the third chapter, the fact that all the universe submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obeys Allah. The fourth chapter regarding the way of Quran in proving the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in creation and provision and things like that. And the fifth chapter is that Tawheed al-Rububiyyah must yield in Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Must yield in Tawheed al-Uluhiyyah. Regarding the first chapter, regarding the meaning of Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, the Lordship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the fact that the mushriks approved of that, he says Tawheed has a general meaning, and that is to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be singled out in Lordship, and that as a result of that, all the worship must be purely for Him, and approve of all the praises by approving the names and attributes for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, as a repetition, the Sheikh says, Tawheed is three types, Rububiyya, Uluhiyya, Tawheed al-Asma wa al-Sifat. Then he starts again with Tawheed al-Rububiyya. The meaning is to unify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with actions that are His actions. Creation is an action of Allah alone. Provision, sustenance, all those things, rulership, order, all those actions are actions of Allah alone. So you must unify Allah in those actions. You should not associate anyone with Allah in creation. You should not associate anyone with Allah in order. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ. To Him belongs all the creation as well as all the rule or the order. And then he cited the verse, Allahu khaliqu kulli shay. Allah is the creator of all things. And then another verse cited here that Allah is the provider. And then another verse cited that Allah is the owner and the king. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala denied about Himself that He has any kind of rival. He has no rival in ownership or in kingship or kingdom or in creation or in order or in rule, no rival, no equal, no supporter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Quran, this is the creation of Allah. So show me what those whom you are worshipping besides Allah, what they have created. Allah is reminding them that they should worship Him alone because there is no creator but Him, and they know that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, who is it to provide for you all what you have? And the one who, if he holds provision, no one can provide you other than him. And he also said, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, which we mentioned the meaning earlier. And he said, Inna Rabbakumullah. This is also rububiyyah and uluhiyyah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, your Lord is the one who deserves worship. Inna Rabbakumullah, الذي خلق السماوات والأرض في ستة أيام. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning the meaning of lordship, the one who has created the heavens and earth, the one who rose upon the throne, and so on. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of the verse says again, تبارك الله رب العالمين. Again, the beginning of the verse, الله ربكم. The end of the verse, الله رب العالمين. And this is so much in Quran. And despite that, we hear those people who say, no, this is a matter which is not mentioned in Quran. This is yani total blindness. And this is total deceit, actually. They know it is mentioned, but this is total deceit. They want to make it a matter of ijtihad so that they play with it. Sawi comes and says Hakimiyyah, and Turabi mentioned 8 or 9 types of Tawheed. Once I heard him, he said, who says that Tawheed is 2 types or 3 types? He says, where is Tawheed al-Siyasa? Where is Tawheed al-Ijtima'? Where is Tawheed al-Iqtisad? Where is Tawheed al-Fan? Fan means music and arts, and he wants to make it a form of Tawheed. You see how could they play easily when it is up to their ijtihad. And they are not mujtahids. They are, at the most, they are some students of knowledge, at the most. But there is no scholar amongst them. This is the admittance of Surur himself. He mentioned it in his magazine, Sunnah. He said, I can say with surety that there is not a single scholar amongst the leaders of those groups. And then he said another statement. He said, most of those leaders, not all of them, most of them don't have the minimum requirement of the knowledge of Sharia. So he is admitting, Muhammad Surur, because he was at a time was fought by Ikhwan and others because he wanted power for himself and he wanted to be a group by himself and a king by himself. So they fought him, so he fought back. And he was saying this in his magazine, As-Sunnah. He says, most of the leaders of those groups don't have the minimum requirement of the knowledge of Sharia. Okay? The minimum requirement means يعني, something that 8-year-old Muslim should know at least. The pillars of salat, the conditions of salat, the pillars of wudu, the conditions of wudu, these are the minimum requirement. And he's saying that most of the leaders of those groups don't have the minimum requirements of the knowledge of Sharia. And he is one of them. He doesn't have the minimum. He is a big mouth who chose to live in the kafir countries because he can shout and cuss and say whatever he wants. That's all. The Sheikh goes on explaining Tawheed al-Rububiyyah, citing the verse, قُلْ مَنْ رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ السَّبْعِ وَرَبُّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ سَيَقُولُونَ لِلَّهِ قُلْ أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, O Muhammad, say to those people, who is the Lord of all heavens and earth and the Lord of the great throne. They would say Allah because they believe that. They believe that Allah is the Lord, Allah is the creator. So, O Muhammad, say, أَفَلَا تَتَّقُونَ. Won't you be aware and worship Allah alone and not worship others besides Him? Won't you be aware? يعني, why do you admit that Allah is the Lord and then you worship others besides Him? This is... And then, similar questions. قُلْ مَنْ بِيَدِهِ مَلَكُوتُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. Who is the one who owns everything? And so on. And they would say, Allah. So, the Prophet ﷺ is ordered to tell them, فَأَنَّا تُسْحَرُونَ. Then, why are you seduced by magic? Not to worship Allah alone. يعني, as if you were seduced by magic or something. So, this kind of tawheed, the Shaykh says, no nation has denied. No nation has denied. And all the hearts have it implanted in it. The messenger said, is there any doubt in Allah? He is the creator of the heavens and earth. So they did not doubt. They did not even doubt that Allah is the creator, Allah is the Lord, Allah is the ruler. They did not deny this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Fir'aun and his people, they denied it by their tongue while their hearts were sure of it due to their arrogance and false pride. وَجَحَدُوا بِهَا وَاسْتَيْقَنَتْهَا أَنفُسُهُمْ ظُلْمًا وَعُلُوًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered Musa to tell Fir'aun, لَقَدْ عَلِمْتَ مَا أَنزَلَ هَؤُلَاءِ إِلَّا رَبُّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ بَصَائِرِ. That Musa was ordered to tell Fir'aun, you know that those signs which you have seen have been sent by the Lord of the heavens and the earth. And Fir'aun did not say, no, I don't know. Because he wanted Musa to ask Allah to remove those hardships that were signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like the blood, like many other signs that Allah has sent down on the people of Fir'aun as a punishment. So in this hardship, Musa was ordered to tell Fir'aun, you know that those signs are from the Lord of the heavens and earth. And Fir'aun did not say no. Because Fir'aun called Musa saying, ask your Lord to remove this hardship from us. So Fir'aun knew. But he was denying by tongue, not denying by heart. And we still have some ignorance who say that kufr cannot occur except by denial of the heart, juhud. We have people like Halabi and others who say this. They say, Halabi in his introduction to the book of Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah, he tried his best to collect some words from here and there from the scholars to deceive the readers, to make them think that kufr is juhud. And he made an introduction for another book which clearly mentioned that kufr cannot occur except by juhud. And that book was refuted by Sheikh bin Baz and the four other members of the fatwa in Saudi Arabia. And then after the death of Sheikh bin Baz, rahimahullah, his two books, Halabi's two books, were refuted by the next committee of fatwa. Okay. And they forbidden those two books. The scholars forbidden those two books, saying that those two books propagate the madhab of irja. Okay. And he is still on the same madhab. He is still going around in the same madhab, writing his books and writing his writings. And not only that, but he is revenging from those scholars in every moment that he can. Revenge, he doesn't spare it, he uses it, okay, by saying bad things about the scars. Anyway, so this kind of tawheed, which is rububiyya, was not actually denied by the nations, even by Fir'aun himself. And similarly, the communists nowadays, who claim that there is no creator or no lord, they say it by tongue. I had an argument with some communists from Russia who were studying with me in Purdue University in 1973 or 4. And in the beginning they said, no, there is no such thing as God and things like that. And then later on, after half an hour of discussion or something, they said, okay, we admit there is someone, a force, who is behind all this universe. I said, this is God. Okay, we say God, and we say he is all able, we say he is all hearing and all seeing and all. And they kept quiet. They admit it, actually. They admit it. Even though they say by tongue. Okay. I remember a Kuwaiti here who was coming to our house in that time, before I go to America. That's in 1970 or 69. And he was posing himself as a communist who, you know, doesn't believe in God and this. And then later on he said, we were only saying this because this was the general trend that you would be able to gain positions. By showing this, you will be gaining positions and you will be leading the people. And now he prays and everything. He doesn't, he forgot about all that. Because it's not from the heart. It's only on the tongue. So deep inside, they don't deny it, as the Sheikh says. It's only the apparent thing. And there is nothing which is created except that it has a creator. Just like there is no trace except that it has a cause. I mean, show me a trace, whatever it might be, which nothing has caused it. It's a trace of what? It's a trace of something, whatever it might be, from a small ant to a big elephant, whatever it might be, or smaller than that. Wherever there is a trace, there is something behind it. Similarly, when there is something which is created, then there must be a creator. And if one looks around him, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encouraged us to look around, this will definitely support what has already been implanted in your heart.